Hi everyone, this is Dr. Ed Park. We're doing a webinar on knee problems. Thank you for joining. So the scope of the problem is that we have knees being the second most common problem that people go to see the doctor, the first being back pain, which we covered 2 weeks ago. So the knees are an inherently unstable and overworked thing because we stand on 2 feet. We don't have 4 feet like our good friends. It's occurring in all ages, of course, but as we get older, think of it like brake pads. The brake pads get worn down, and we'll see that in a second, that although we have an advantage over cars in that our brake pads are regenerating through stem cells, this is an issue. So what contributes to it? Of course, injury, aging weakens the structures, arthritides, which are the many kinds of arthritis we can get, weakness of the muscles, and conformation. Conformation is an idea I like to introduce. If you look above me, there's horse's legs. Horse's legs can be splayed out, pigeon-toed, knock-kneed, or valgus. They can be bow-legged or varus, just like humans. So humans should avail themselves of orthotics if they have poor alignment or conformation. So I bring back the octagon above because basically, all diseases can be linked back to telomere erosion insofar as that the telomeres shorten, the stem cells deplete and get damaged, and then the tissues from those stem cells, meaning the cartilage, the bone, the ligaments, and the muscles and tendons, they degenerate. So what are the knees? The knees is the confluence or the joining together of the long bone of the femur and then the two bones of the lower leg, yeah? So it has a knee cap on top. So the extensor muscles of the knee are the quadriceps. Quadriceps is four heads. So we have the rectus femoris, that crosses two joints. In other words, it crosses the kneecap, it also crosses the hip and inserts on the pelvis. So why is that important? Because that is the one out of the four heads that can cause hip flexion. And then of course, as it crosses the kneecap, it causes knee extension or lower leg extension. The other three heads are shown here, the lateralis, the vastus lateralis, the vastus medius, and the vastus intermedius underneath if you peel back the rectus femoris. The patella, as I mentioned, is a bone. It ossifies or becomes bony in childhood, and it sits there on the femoral groove. In other words, it's not just floating around, it's got its own little articulation with the femur underneath it. Ligament, the powerful quadriceps tendon made from the four heads, comes through the patella or wraps around it and it inserts on the tibia below. In kids, and especially kids that are athletic, when I was playing volleyball in high school, I got these. They're called Osgood Slaughters. This is from the tibial insertion of that strong patellar tendon, and you get a painful bump there. That's not an uncommon lesion. So what flexes? We saw the extensors are the quads. The flexors are shown in this blue cartoon. Below the knee, you have the calf muscles or the gastrocnemius. And then above the knee, we have the hamstrings. The hamstrings are consisting of the biceps femoris. Just like the arm has a bicep, the leg has a bicep for flexion. So that bicep femoris has two heads, bicep, two heads. The short head just inserts there on the femur, the long one crosses the hip joint, therefore allowing for extension of the leg, or maybe kicking your hip back. It's a hip extender and a knee flexor. On the medial side, we have what's called the semimembranosus and the semitendinosus. They just call it that because it looks flat like a membrane. That's the deeper one, and the semitendinosus looks like half of it is a tendon. And that those are the ones, the hamstrings on the medial side. Now we also have some minor knee flexors that come down in the pes anserinus. That's shown in this lower left, pes anserinus meaning goose foot. And so we have the gracilis, which is a hip adductor, and we have the sartorius, the one that wraps around from Latin for tailor. And then we have the semitendinosus, the more superficial of those hamstrings medially. The joint capsule is a waterproof bag of fluid. It's where the joint fluid is, and that it protects and lubricates that powerful joint. It wraps around the back and the sides to form the posterior, you can see above me, medial, the medial posterior capsule and the lateral posterior capsule. So it's a fluid-filled sac for the joint. If you're going to treat, this is where you want to inject, because all the important structures in the joint will be bathed together. I wanted to point out, I had a discussion with a patient who opted for stem cells over exosomes, and she said, well, why don't you just put it in the pouch like the other doctors? And I said, well, I was trained in that ultrasound technique, but you can see that the suprapatellar pouch there, it is kissing the joint capsule, or the big pouch, but 15% of the time it doesn't communicate, so it's a separate waterproof bag. So even though it's an easy ultrasound technique, you have that 15% risk that it's not going directly where you want it. We talk about bursae with the shoulders. This is bursae in the knees. We see these little blue pouches. There's a prepatellar bursa, meaning in front of the kneecap or patella. That can sometimes get swollen. Below, we have the infrapatellar bursae, both deep and subcutaneous. Above, we have the suprapatellar bursae. That's the easy one to get with ultrasound, but again, communicates 85% of the time with the joint. The joint capsule is missing here. We have the popliteal bursa behind. Popliteal fossa just means that knee pit. And then we have the pes anserinus bursa. If we look at the middle cartoon or drawing, we see again what I mentioned, the sartorius, gracilis, and the semitendinosus all insert there in a goose shape or goose foot shaped thing. Underneath is the pes anserinus bursa. This gets irritated sometimes in runners, heavier women because of the angles of the hip and the pressure there, and side sleepers. If side sleepers have a problem, or people with flat feet, they can sleep with a pillow between their knees. If you're a side sleeper, you should always sleep with a pillow between your knees anyway. So if you have water on the knee, how do you know if it's in the knee or on the, above the kneecap? Well, if it's prepatellar or in the prepatellar bursa, you won't have restriction of your motion. So that's shown in the to my right or on the left of the screen. This is typical among people who have to kneel for a living, let's say nuns, gardeners, plumbers, housekeepers. And so it can be ameliorated, I think, a little bit with wearing kneecaps as protection. In contrast, when you have the effusion in the knee joint capsule itself, this will limit your motion. And there are a myriad number of reasons why this could occur. All the arthritises, gout, pseudo-gout, trauma to the interior structures can cause water on the knee, as well as infection. Osteoarthritis is the final common pathway. If we have a car for 120,000 miles, we don't expect to have the same brake pads under normal use, as I mentioned. So we're all headed there unless science or exosomes or something mitigates that. Luckily, the stem cells, if they're not too compromised in terms of aging or dysfunction and or depletion, they can regenerate throughout a life. So what we see in the x-ray above is that a normal joint space isn't bone on bone. There's that clear area by x-ray, and that's not actually space. That's actually cartilage lying on cartilage. We can see this in the healthy cadaveric specimen above. You see that beautiful thick spongy Teflon. It's called hyaline cartilage, and they're gliding and rotating, and that's what makes us makes it able for us to use the knees. In the radiograph on the right, we see loss of joint space, so-called bone on bone, and that would be shown to the right autopsy. We have pink on pink, which is just bone on bone. The brake pads have worn down, if you will. The cartilage is actually generated from the bone, from the subchondral area, and a healthy bone is going to make healthy cartilage. As the osteoarthritis progresses in our lives, what happens is we get osteophytes, which is kind of a local reaction, and the bone has little spurs or outcroppings. It can also have pits or cysts. Inside the joint, we have two important strong ligaments called the cruciate ligaments. They're cruciate because they cross. So a good way to remember this is the anterior cruciate ligament is when you put your right hand in your right pocket. It goes from top to bottom and right to left, whereas the posterior cruciate ligament goes from left to right and bottom to top. Okay, so let's look at this. In the diagram to my left here, you can see that the anterior cruciate ligament is torn. This would occur when the foot is fixed and the body falls back. And the doctor will test this by pulling on the lower leg in a, what's called the anterior drawer test. If there's too much give there, that anterior ligament could be compromised, or if it's painful, it could be damaged. So two important intracapsular ligaments, the anterior and the posterior cruciate ligament. Anterior is almost always injured because of, look above me, you'll see this motion. The person who is depicted here has his thigh towards the midline, and there's a valgus force, meaning a knock-kneeing force from outside to in. The ankle is everted, and the femur is twisting on the tibial plateau. This all leads to traction on the anterior cruciate ligament, and the cruciate ligament can be compromised. The menisci are these fibrocartilaginous rings. They're actually not complete rings, and meniscus is Latin for crescent. So if you take off the femur and look down from above, as we see in these pinkish diagrams, there are two. There's a lateral meniscus or crescent and a medial meniscus or crescent. And then you can also see our friends there, the anterior and posterior cruciate ligaments in cross-section. So it's kind of like those in a metal bottle cap, those liners. It's a really tough kind of plasticky liner. And if it gets injured, it can get injured in a myriad of ways, of course. There can be a cut, a flap, a bucket handle. It doesn't really matter. But the point is, aging contributes to this, but usually it's a traumatic event that causes it. And you can tell if you have it because, as I've had it before, I got it from doing 300 golf swings in a row like an idiot, and I just sheared it off into my right knee. So you get locking, clicking, and pain with certain movements. If you want to test it, stand on one leg and do a chubby checker twist. If there's pain, clicking, then you might have a meniscal tear. The treatment will depend on your age. There's a lot of ages in there. If you're young, they go, hey, yeah, it's going to fix. You're young. But if you're older, say older being above 35, they might say, ah, it's not worth it. So if it's really symptomatic and you don't want to just try and see if it heals, mine happened to heal mostly just by taking TA65 and recharge. If you are, if the doctor says, well, it's in the inside, the inner third of the meniscus, that's called the white cartilage, and that whiteness means it's not red. The outer third is red, meaning it has better vasculature. It's likely to repair if they sew it. But if it's on the middle third in the white cartilage and you're older, the doctor might just offer you either conservative management or snipping it off. Of course, snipping it off will lead to more friction and perhaps accelerate osteoarthritis. So we're moving to the extracapsular ligaments. We talked about the intracapsular, which is the anterior and the posterior cruciate. And now we have the lateral and the medial collateral. Now remember, the big toe is on the big bone side, okay? So the little bone is the fibula. That's the lateral side. The outside is where the little bone is. So the lateral collateral ligament is the fibular collateral ligament. If you push the knee from inside to out in a varus motion, right, bow legging, you can tear that ligament. The more common one is the medial collateral ligament. Again, medial, big toe side, tibia is the inside ligament. Usually a valgus force, meaning a knock-kneeing force from the outside in, tears that ligament. You look at the ligaments from behind, there's a popliteal muscle, that little red thing. We see the deep semimembranosus tendon that's behind the pes anserinus. And then we see an oblique popliteal ligament. So here again, the ligaments, if you get a force from the inside out, you can tear the lateral or fibular. From outside in, you tear the medial or the tibial collateral ligament. These are common injuries in sports. The grade depends on how badly it's torn. A grade one tear is just an injury, a bruise, a sprain, that'll heal with time and rest. A grade two is a partial tear, also will probably heal with time and rest thanks to those stem cells if they're healthy and not undergoing tendinosis. And then a complete tear is a grade three or avulsion. This is probably going to require surgery, yeah? So we put them all together. We got the anterior cruciate ligament, we got the collateral ligament, usually the medial, and we got the menisci. And so if you get an injury of all three, it's called the unhappy triad, a very common injury. It's shown in the skier, in this football player. What we see here is the left foot is planted, but the back or the rest of the body is pulling backwards. We also, I've reversed the image, it's harder to read, but we have those forces of femoral adduction. We've got a valgus force, a knock-kneeing force from outside in. We have twisting of the upper body and all its weight on the tibial plateau, and we have the knee planted and everted with the lower leg abducted. All these conspire to cause a sudden trauma to all three of the unhappy triad. And what are they? It's the ACL tears, the meniscus shears or gets injured, and then the medial collateral ligament will pop. And you can see that illustrated quite well in the football player, in the skier, and in this diagram to my left. Unhappy triad, ACL, usually torn medial meniscus and torn medial collateral ligament. And people will often tell you they felt the pop. They'll never forget it. It's pretty gruesome. It happened to my sister, actually. So what are the treatments? Well, treatments obviously are prevention. I hope Doug will mention a little bit about this band he wears over where the Osgood Slaughter lesion would be. Physical therapy can be done, but try to prevent it. Wear orthotics if you need them. Don't run in situations like the road running. Doug said he stopped that 2 decades ago because it was hurting his knees. So be good to your knees. Pain is a signal of impending or ongoing injury. It's not a sign of weakness. When you do get injured, you can go watch a YouTube video on how to rehab it. There's a lot of great stuff there. We do the rice represents rest, ice, compression, elevation. Whether this really helps, I mean, you're just decreasing inflammation, which is good, and you're decreasing the pain, but the healing is going to be an immunological phenomenon. In other words, the body recruits cells to come in, eat up the dead cells. It recruits MSCs or mesenchymal stem cells to come, release their exosomes and stimulate new growth and regeneration. So if you're interested in this sort of thing, go to exosome video number 5, where I talk about the history of regenerative medicine in about 40 minutes. Basically, it's some guy thought, I'll inject some poisonous sugar in there, cause inflammation, and the inflammation will make the joint stronger. So there's prolotherapy, there's steroids, which they've been doing for decades, and then there's prolotherapy again with PRP. If you want to understand that, go to exosome video webinar number 5, and on YouTube, my channel is DRPARK65. And there I go more into the concept of itis versus osis. Itis means irritation or inflammation. Osis is like tendinosis and arthrosis. It means it's not really irritated. You don't see white blood cells, inflammation, all that, or even pain. So when I took my 2-day seminar in ultrasound joint injections, I made friends with a colleague who's a rheumatologist. She's tapped probably 1,000 knees, and she remarked to me that it's usually a sterile effusion. Water on the knee in a 75-year-old woman is going to be sterile. It's not itis, it's osis. In other words, that goes with my telomere theory, that these things are burnt out. They can no longer copy. And so it's a very different pathology from itis. I also learned in that seminar that if you inject tennis elbow, okay, epicondyle, lateral, with steroids, you run a risk of atrophy of the tendon. And that's because you weren't treating itis, you were treating osis. And we know that cartilage, bone, connective tissue is destroyed by high-dose steroids. What people have been doing for the last 15 years is using hyaluronic acid. Now this does work. It only lasts 2-3 months, maybe a little longer. You put this jelly in there. It's a disaccharide, highly cross-linked. It's like KO syrup or the thick cornstarch syrup. You put it in the joint and it lubricates. That naturally, there is hyaluronic acid in that joint along with synovial fluid. Hyaluronic acid is just this substance that makes up all our connective tissues, skin everywhere. It's quite expensive. It's not really painful. Sometimes you have to repeat it weekly, but that can provide some symptomatic relief, although whether it mitigates or improves the overall course is doubtful, as is the injection of steroids. Steroids can make you feel better, but whether it improves in the long run, it's probably the opposite. It actually probably causes chondrotoxicity or toxicity to the cartilage. Of course, when things are very bad, what you're gonna do is have an orthopedic surgeon go in there with the instruments, the arthroscopic instruments, and cut off the meniscus or screw in some cadaveric implant. And that way you can restore the menisci and the ligament, et cetera. Sometimes I talk to patients who've undergone fenestration. That's creating a bunch of holes in the bone, causing it to bleed, and hoping that that reaction will regenerate the cartilage. And sometimes it does. And when all else fails, you're looking at above me, the knee replacement. The total knee replacement replaces the tibial plateau and the femoral condyles for a new articulating surface. This is a big procedure, although it does work. Interestingly, about 30% of people, according to a Cornell study, still complain of significant pain after a knee replacement. But why would that be? I mean, think about the processes that caused the knee to go bad in the first place. You haven't really changed those, meaning the bone is still not 100%. You could have microfractures, you could have bad tendons, muscles, and ligaments. So it's not a guarantee of no pain, but it is quite a good procedure. Finally, let's wrap it up with my exosome experience. You can see the procedure demonstrated above me. Basically, we can feel very easily the joint line between the femur and the tibia. We have them sit in a chair, so the leg is dangling by gravity, opening that space up. And you can feel that strong patellar tendon. And right to the right or left of that, there's a space. In the cartoon, you can see the fat underneath. And so it's very easy to feel. We mark it with a sterile pen, and then we prep the field. We numb it with some lidocaine. The procedure is really pretty painless, I would say. I've done it to myself, even without anesthesia. As you go, the patient will tell you if they feel something, and that's a good guide to getting to the correct space, which is actually quite easy to do. If you do hit bone, cartilage, or ligament, that's helpful information. We don't want to do that, obviously. So let's talk about my results. I would say this is probably one of the easiest and most successful treatments. 46 out of 48 patients said they got an improvement, including myself and my mom. Two people I can talk about who were not happy were BD. She's a 53-year-old woman, very heavy and stands a lot. And so she was bone on bone at 53. We did 4 billion injection. She did call me, say that she was hiking Appalachia and it was a little better, but not enough to stave off a knee replacement. So she's happy now. She got her new knees. VC is my friend for 8-9 years. He's been taking TA65. He runs or walks mostly two miles a day. And he wanted to try it. He tried it. And he said it didn't work. So 2 months later, he got a steroid injection. He said that fixed it. Steroids typically don't last more than 2 months in symptomatic pain relief. And now he's about 9 months out. So it's possible that the exosomes also contributed to him feeling better at this point, although he attributes it all to the steroids. Some of the people that really were happy were WZ, who lives now, he's a neighbor of mine. I met him in February, we did his knees, and he was actually contemplating knee replacement, and luckily he didn't need that because the pain went away, he was able to continue walking. When I came back to Hawaii, he got a second injection last month, and now he's still walking 2 months, he couldn't be happier, so that was a good result. Deb is on the line. We're going to talk to her last. She's 66. She had an injection a year ago, and interestingly, we put MSC exosomes, amniotic fluid exosomes, and hyaluronic acid. Doug, who's 81, and he got an injection. I think he was the third person I treated. Second person, maybe, Mom or Doug. Doug's a friend of mine, and we treated him in May of 2019. And that year, he actually ran the Trans Rockies, which is 121 miles in 6 days. Amazing. He's been amazing for decades, but I think his performance has changed. So we'll get to him second. He also got injection in May of 2020. And this year, he's run 2,020 miles as of August. So he'll probably hit 3,000. Finally, Lynn Kagawa, I'll check if she's on the line. She's working now, but she graciously agreed to talk to us. She's a 56-year-old woman. With a lifelong history of martial arts, kickboxing, Shotokan karate. She used to kick a lot. So we did a very low dose in her knees back in February when I was here at the University of Hawaii giving a talk. And she said they felt better. She couldn't wait. She kept on saying, oh, I wish you were in Hawaii. So I moved to Hawaii, and she was the first person we retreated. And so she got another treatment, a higher dose with hyaluronic acid. We also have injected her shoulder and her fingers for reasons. So we'll talk to Lynn first. So Lynn, get ready to be unmuted if you're there. I just want to finish up with RA. He's kind of a funny guy. These are his legs below. You can see his very powerful calf muscles and quadriceps. He leg presses routinely several times a week, 1,000 pounds. I don't know why, but he runs up hills. He's very much using his knees. And you can see that he's kind of the whack-a-mole, I call him. When I first met him in November of last year, he said, hey, I already paid a deposit on stem cell treatment because my knees are hurting on the right. So just do the left and we'll do like an A-B experiment. So we did only his left, and his right continued to hurt, but the left was great. So when I came back in February, he got both treated. Both were pretty good. A couple of weeks ago, we did his right. So both sides had gotten two treatments. And then like whack-a-mole, he said, this is so great. I want to get ahead. I want equity. I want to put in the bank. So he actually has done three treatments now. He just quickly did another left and then a right. So three treatments each. So he's really trying to get ahead and be proactive. So Doug, tell us about your knees. How have they been?
Immensely better. Let's say the left one is like, I don't even feel anything on the left one. And the right one, it's like it was 15, 20 years ago rather than recently. And up to then, yeah, every once in a while, because I jaywalk all the time, I'd sprint across the street so I wouldn't get run over by cars. And then I'd have to walk for like a football field to loosen them up. I don't have to do that anymore. In other words, the pain of the knee, right, if I'm just walking, isn't there. Yeah, I do. When I go out on the trails, I run a lot, but I do use those Mueller knee straps still anytime I go out on the trails.
Great.
So thanks for joining us. I'm excited to see you in a couple of weeks.
Yeah. Another exercise for me.
You're looking good.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah. So tell us about your knees. I just briefly, for those that just tuned in, Deb had an injection a year ago, and she couldn't really do even one squat without pain. Since then, she's done 100 a day, so that's like 37,000 squats, right?
Yes. I haven't missed a day yet. I think it really helps my knees to stay healthy, to keep them moving like that. And it's a really good exercise to do, you know, as a minimum exercise every day. So I've kept with it. I really didn't think at first that I would be able to do it at all. We saw the 100 squats a day challenge on YouTube, and my friend and I decided to have a contest and see who would win that. She dropped out after a couple of weeks, and so I got a good lunch out of it, but I keep doing the squats. But my knees are a lot stronger now. I want them to get even stronger than they are, but the gym has been closed lately, so.
But now, so your legs must be very strong. Your butt must be really strong. How's your low back?
All of that's better. You know, you can't do 100 squats a day without improving the whole mechanism there. So,
correct.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's now, interestingly, Deb, you did, I've been there at least five times, maybe six, and you've gotten injections for your dad and for yourself, IV and nasally. You've gotten quite a lot. You may have even passed mom. Tell me, what other things other than, tell us about the thyroid and any other changes you've noticed in your perceptions or?
Now, I was mentioning the last time I saw you that when I had my blood test a couple of months ago, my thyroid function had improved. I knew I was feeling better. About 10 years ago, I was diagnosed with hypothyroidism and they put me on medication. And since then, my thyroid test every year has been at a low normal, and this last test was at a high normal, and so I think that's the reason I feel, you know, have more energy lately, which is good. So I have that. I really enjoy the intranasal injections. They give me some clarity of thought. You know, I can read better, easier. I can it's just easier to read and understand things. I was starting to, I think, decline in that area. So that's really helped me. So, and I really expected by now to have to get another knee injection.
Yeah, I think you did the best. And perhaps, you know, interestingly, you had the amniotic fluid exosomes. I've not done that combination. Maybe that was particularly effective in you. So I might reincorporate that again, because I think you've had probably one of the best results, not having to repeat the knee injection.
Yeah. So if they get sore again, though, I know what to do.
Well, I look forward to seeing you in a couple of weeks. Thanks for joining in.
Yeah. Nice to talk to you, too.
When's Dad coming back up?
Well, he probably will be here in a month or two. So we'll get with you about that, too.
December when I swing back.
Yes.
Okay. That'd be great. Thanks so much, Deb.
Thank you, Dr. Park.
Bye.
Take care.